Welcome to Season 5 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former health commissioner here in Baltimore, Maryland. Our goal with this podcast is to bring scientific evidence and experience to shed light on critical health issues. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Today, we're talking about long COVID. I speak to Dr. Jonathan Whiteson, a physiatrist at New York University, about emerging evidence on how best to treat patients with this debilitating condition. Let's listen. Dr. Jonathan Whiteson, thank you so much for joining me on Public Health On Call to talk about long COVID. Now, you are a physiatrist at New York University, is that right?
Yes, I'm a physiatrist at NYU Langone Health, part of Rusk Rehabilitation, correct.
Great. And I want to just start by asking you some basic questions about your own experience, maybe just starting with what is a physiatrist, because a lot of people may not be familiar with that branch of medicine.
So a physiatrist is a physician who's trained in the field of physical medicine and rehabilitation, and we're the ideal physicians to evaluate people from a holistic perspective when it comes to their functioning, both physical and cognitive functioning. And we're sort of the ideal physician to really understand how someone's medical condition, whether it be heart disease, lung disease, neurologic disease, an operation, is impacting their ability to fulfill their role in society. So we evaluate patients from the medical perspective, the strength, physical, functional perspective, and we coordinate a multi-specialty team to help restore patients back to their optimum physical, functional health.
And so when there's not a pandemic, what would be a typical patient for a physiatrist?
So physiatrists work in both the inpatient and the outpatient setting. In the outpatient setting, we see patients with musculoskeletal disorders, chronic neurologic disorders like Parkinson's disease or multiple sclerosis, people who've had strokes or spinal cord injuries. Myself, I'm a specialist in the areas of heart and lung rehabilitation. So I see people who've had heart attacks or have debility from chronic lung disease. And on the inpatient side as well, we see people who have had acute injuries, major trauma, fractures, spinal cord injuries, acute strokes, heart transplants, lung transplants. So we see a full gamut of patients when they're debilitated, inpatient and outpatient.
And so you're really generalists.
So yes, as a field, we cover the entire span of medical conditions and the age groups as well, from pediatric to geriatric and everything in between. But many physiatrists do specialize down. Some work solely in the outpatient setting, musculoskeletal. Others work only on the inpatient setting, taking care of neurologic patients. So we do tend to specialize down into our areas. But yes, we have a very general and broad training.
And then comes COVID and this syndrome that starts to get reported that people don't just recover and go back to life as usual after their illness.
Yeah, so this has been very interesting. It's a whole new world for us, a whole new field and specialty that we've had to learn very quickly about and really come up with an understanding both from experience, but also from the early research that's being done on COVID. And we really look at this in two areas. First is those patients who are sick and in the hospital with COVID and what are their needs. And then when they leave the hospital, they have unique rehabilitation needs. And then there's another group, which is a much larger group, and what you're referring to, which is the long haulers, those people who had COVID, they got over their acute illness, but 3-4 weeks or several months later, they're still suffering from fatigue and aches and difficulty thinking and breathing challenges, chest pain. And these are the long haulers, the condition we have termed post-acute sequela of COVID, or PASC. And this is a field that podiatrists and rehabilitation medicine is really suited to taking care of. It's a multi-organ disorder. And as physiatrists, we're multi-organ specialists in terms of rehabilitation.
When did it occur to you that this would become such a big part of your clinical career? I mean, at what point did you realize this wasn't just about infectious disease, that this was going to turn into an issue for physical medicine and rehabilitation.
In New York City, we had the privilege, so to speak, of a tsunami of COVID infections in March of 2020. And very soon after that time that patients were being admitted into the hospital, we recognized there was going to be a tremendous need for rehabilitative care for those hospitalized patients. In terms of the long-haul patients, myself and our specialty of physiatric medicine really started to recognize the syndrome or the condition of long-haul COVID probably May or June of 2020. And really since that time, as we saw the numbers tremendously skyrocket, we recognized there was going to be a need for a specialty care of these patients with long-haul COVID. We recognized really from that point on, it was going to be a long-term public health issue.
And so you opened a clinic at NYU. How busy is it?
So we've opened a clinic here at NYU, the NYU post-COVID care program. It's been operational over the past year to 14 months. And every day we're seeing more and more patients. I myself see about three new patients every single day. It is a multi-specialty clinic, as many post-COVID programs are around the country. Myself as a physiatrist, I partner with a pulmonologist and a primary care physician. But we also have neurologists and psychiatrists and nephrologists and other specialists involved as well. Because as I said, this is a multi-organ disorder and requires really multi-specialty evaluation and management.
And so a typical patient, one of your daily three new patients shows up, what would be a not uncommon story?
So most of my patients are coming to see me as a physiatrist with fatigue. And fatigue is this symptom of tiredness that despite sleep or rest, doesn't seem to resolve. And activity intolerance, normal activities like washing and dressing and walking down the street or doing a daily shop would not normally cause someone to become tired, but those individuals with PASC who have fatigue are tired out of proportion to the activities that they were normally able to tolerate. So many patients come with fatigue, others come with difficulty with thinking and focusing in the popular press has been termed brain fog, but people show signs of cognitive impairment with challenges with word retrieval and focus and concentration and memory. And others have persistent issues with shortness of breath. Others will have chest pain. Others have a sense of joint swelling or aches in their muscles. But overall, functionally, they're impaired. They can't live their normal lives. They cannot exercise like they used to or go to work like they used to. Some find it hard to walk down the street.
And so then you're able to give them this comprehensive assessment. Now, I understand that the American Academy of Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation has tried to take the experience and evidence that's been garnered over the last couple years now and put together organized guidelines and recommendations about how to take care of patients with this set of conditions. And you've been involved with that.
Yes, absolutely. So as physiatrists, we are members of the American Academy of Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation. And really from an early stage, we recognize the need for collaboration. My experience, someone's experience in Washington or in California, we needed to collaborate and put that experience together. This is a new condition. We don't have years of scientific research to guide us, so we needed our experience. So we came together as a multidisciplinary collaborative. It's really the first and only collaborative, and it is with mostly physiatrists, but we have other specialists as well, including, as I mentioned, cardiologists and pulmonologists and psychiatrists. And we also have, and this is very significant, very important for us, we have patient representation too. Patients who've experienced COVID and who continue to experience long-haul syndrome, we've come together to hear their story, but to put together our experience so we can create guidance for other clinicians out there who are still learning and need information on how to manage, how to evaluate and manage individuals with fatigue, with cognitive limitations, with breathing or heart limitations. So that's been the role of the American Academy of Physical Medicine Rehabilitation, to bring together and to run this collaborative, but also to take that further and also represent the patients, but also the clinicians at a governmental level. And we've been to Washington and we've been advocating and working with the CDC to really make sure that Washington's government is providing enough funds to research and understand post-COVID, but also to provide facilities for care for individuals who have long COVID.
So I understand that this work in coming up with recommendations for evaluating and treating patients has proceeded sort of symptom by symptom. You have a guideline for fatigue, you have a guideline for the brain fog type cognitive symptoms, you have a guideline for breathing problems, and you're working on other guidelines by symptom. Let's go maybe as an example, the kind of things that have come out of this process. Let's pick fatigue. Let's say I've had COVID, I show up, I'm exhausted, I can't seem to get enough sleep. I'm sure I'm happy to have found you because you're a doctor who knows that this is a serious problem. You're not just going to tell me to go take a nap. But what happens then according to the kind of guidance that you put together?
So the guidance really stresses a comprehensive evaluation of an individual presenting with fatigue and recognizing that while we have written these guidelines according to symptom, most patients don't show up with one symptom of fatigue only. They will have multiple symptoms. But we address this by symptomatology because we felt that was the best way to manage it. At the end of the day, when all the guidelines are written, it will form a very comprehensive evaluation. As any evaluation of any new condition or new patient, it starts with a history and a physical examination. And that's key to really understand how severe the COVID was, the duration of symptoms, the combination of symptoms, and the fluctuation of those symptoms. Any prior workup that's been done before, have there been blood tests taken? We look to evaluate and make sure there's no other reasons for fatigue, such as low blood count or anemia or abnormalities in kidney function or dehydration. So we recommend certain blood tests as a baseline should be taken. Some other people have an associated shortness of breath. There may be an indication for a chest x-ray. Some people will be having some coexistent chest pain and EKG may be required. So the history, looking at tests, the physical examination, and many times though, what we're finding is the laboratory tests, the physical examination is normal, but yet people continue to complain of fatigue. And then it comes down to evaluating diet, activity, and sleep. You mentioned sleep, and sleep is very important with fatigue because many people have non-restorative sleep, and there can be very different reasons for non-restorative sleep, but it's important to understand what might be going wrong with the sleep because it is very important in helping people to improve sleep so that they can overcome that fatigue.
How do you help people cope with these really debilitating and demoralizing symptoms? Obviously, you're trying to figure out what might be behind them. You're trying to help treat them, but I'm sure it's enormously frustrating for patients.
It is frustrating. And many times people are saying, well, is there a treatment? Is there a medication? Is there a pill that you can give me that will help me overcome the fatigue? And at this point, no, there isn't. And that can add to the frustration because there's no easy remedy to this situation. So coping comes in different ways. Number one is the practical advice in terms of a healthy diet. We've been recommending the Mediterranean-style diet, which is rich in antioxidants, avoidance of alcohol, because many patients have not done well with alcohol, minimizing unnecessary medications, which can make people feel fatigued or tired, making sure that people are well hydrated with water, and titrated activity and exercise, avoidance of overactivity. Many people who have fatigue with post-COVID, if they do too much, they crash. They feel more fatigued. They feel sick. They can have an exacerbation of their symptoms. So a very slow, personally titrated progression of activity is important. And then what I think you were sort of really referring to is how do we support people emotionally? And one of the things that we have now is several years, close to several years of experience, and experience not just from the patients I've seen, but from the colleagues that I speak to around the country, we do see that many people are recovering. So we give reassurance to people that whilst they're going through a difficult time, whilst their course may fluctuate, they can have days and weeks where they feel better, days and weeks where they don't, the general trend is good. And also, many people have required some emotional support, not just from myself as a physician, but from psychologists. And we do refer people through to psychologists or social workers to provide that support. And lastly, I'll say that there are patient groups, as I mentioned, we have patient representation in our collaborative, but the patient groups meet as well, and they provide each other with significant support through those patient forums.
Now, you referenced getting involved in policy, and I can imagine it's not a small number of people who are suffering these symptoms. And there are only a few places. I know Johns Hopkins has a clinic, NYU has your program, but there are maybe not enough comprehensive centers for all the people who could be having these symptoms. What are you asking for? What's the highlights? What are the highlights of your agenda for the government?
Well, I think recognizing that long-haul COVID is a public health issue and it's going to be around. It's not going to go away anytime soon. And you're right. There are a significant number of patients who have a long-haul syndrome, and it could be as many as 13 to 15 million people around the country who at this current time have some kind of debilitating symptom related to COVID. So we do need local government, but also the federal government, to recognize this as a public health issue and to really start to fund research into these conditions so we understand the basis of the symptoms that people are experiencing. And that is starting to happen. The NIH are putting together funds and are giving out funds for research, but also to make sure that individuals who are disabled from long-haul COVID are recognized as such and have access to short-term and long-term disability as needed. The health system really does need to recognize that there are millions of people impacted and that we need to build more clinics. Our collaborative has 36 programs, 36 clinics involved. 36 clinics around the country, you're right. The population at need is underserved. We need to recognize that, dedicate more funds, and have greater coordination to make sure that everyone around the country who needs access to a clinic can get that access.
Well, Dr. Jonathan Whiteson, thanks so much for walking me through this. And thanks so much for your work with people who've been suffering from the long-term effects of COVID.
Thank you. I appreciate you highlighting this.
Public Health On Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker, Matthew Martin, Spencer Greer, and Holly Cardinal, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media support from Grace Holz Fernandez. Thank you for listening.